It's been a long 9 years since the last mainline serious Sam game, but it's finally here, and it's not finished yet. Behind its problems is a good game, but it's not where it should be right now. After the first encounter, a gathering of developers got snapped up by Take-Two Interactive, who then signed a deal with Crow Team while they were busy making Second Encounter the absolute banger that it is. Out of this deal came two games developed by Climax Studios. One was Next Encounter, a follow-up on the classic style. The core gameplay is the same, but it added a combo system that temporarily boosted your speed, and some weapons had alternate ammo types. The second one was Serious Sam Advance, which is just miserable. But in 2005, Crow Team's Big Chungus arrived and divided the fanbase into a group that loves it and a group that hates it with the burning rage of 1,000 lava golems. For the most part, it follows the same ideas as the classics, but instead of being a colorful shooter that doesn't take itself very seriously, it's more of a Saturday morning cartoon in FPS form that tries hard to be funny and usually fails at it. While it had problems, the gameplay is good fun, even if turrets and vehicles are a red flag brighter than the sun. The dedicated grenade button flows surprisingly well with the combat, and if nothing else, the visuals and especially the soundtrack fit the cartoon style perfectly. Still, Crow Team has plans to reimagine Serious Sam 2 in a style closer to the rest of the series, but as of this video, nothing concrete exists yet. Anyway, after that comes the part about Crow Team having financial problems and working with Atari to develop a military shooter, which got cancelled and thrown down the toilet. Crow Team also pitched a Doom game to id Software, but didn't get the job because of time zones and communication issues. In the end, Crow Team had to lay off some of its staff, and the remaining members were stuck with a bunch of half-finished assets that were going to waste. So, hey, why not use them to make another Serious Sam game, right? And thus, now working with Devolver Digital, Serious Sam 3 BFE got released in 2011. I'll cover it in detail one day, but let's just say that 3 is kind of the opposite of 2. In an age of Call of Duty wannabes, the game was a breath of fresh air, but in retrospective, it aged like a bottle of Gnar milk. Against all hurdles, the visuals actually looked pretty good from a technical standpoint, and for better or for worse, Crow Team got their money's worth out of those assets. The music was banging as always, and when the combat finally gets going, it really gets going and hits some of the highest peaks of the series. But the dull art style, the repetitive environments, the low-effort secrets, the god-awful underground sections, the questionable gameplay decisions, and most levels just not being very good, resulted in a game that is thoroughly mediocre and completely joyless. Fusion improved it a bit, and some custom campaigns greatly improved the experience, but this is easily my least favorite entry in the mainline series. Oh, and the HD remakes happened sometime in the middle of this too, I guess. Regardless, Crow Team managed to pull themselves up from their hole, and began working on Serious Sam 4. This leads us to 2014's The Talos Principle, which is the polar opposite of Serious Sam, a deep, thoughtful puzzle game with a strong focus on telling a story about existentialism. Some of Serious Sam 4's initial concepts included slower sections with puzzles, and those concepts ended up evolving into the Talos Principle. And in turn, a number of assets that appeared in the Talos Principle are reused in the Serious Sam 4 that exists today. So yeah, let's talk about it already. Jumping from the encounters straight into the new hotness is kinda weird, but hey, I'm just following the Serious Sam timeline as an example. Serious Sam 4 is a prequel to 3, dealing with an earlier point in the invasion of Earth. It begins with the player controlling Sam for a few moments during a decisive battle against Mentos' army, before Thanos jumps into the fray, sets everything on fire, and punches Sam in the balls. The scene shifts to 92 hours before, as Sam and the alien artifact acquisition team make their way to Rome in search of the Holy Grail. It doesn't take long before the convoy gets attacked by Mento's forces, and Sam is forced to go on foot, together with Kenny, the fresh new guy. And if you thought this intro is all you're getting, you better buckle up, because this game has more story and dialogue than every other mainline title combined, split between cutscenes and banter between the members of Sam's team. The game presents a nice down-to-earth look at Sam himself, mixing together his tough action hero demeanor and the depiction from Serious Sam 2, where he was a bit of a doofus. As one of the loading screen quotes says, Sam is like a nuclear warhead on a pogo stick. But the rest of the characters are a mixed bag. Professor Kiesel and Father Damien have their funny accents, Kenny is a likable guy with nice shoes, and Carter's antics are entertaining. But Rodriguez is just obnoxious, and Jones and Hellfire, well, they're there, I guess. Akriman is also just a philosophy dump on legs, and General Brand's character is sorely underdeveloped. The plot itself is kinda balls too, with one particularly egregious scene where a character goes full retard. And ultimately, most of the dialogue is neither interesting nor funny, which is bad because there's way more of it now. I choked about the old subtitle reminding me of Borderlands, but the writing in Serious Sam 4 falls into the same pit of trying to be quirky and funny all the time. But thankfully, the gameplay doesn't, for the most part. That said, I also think it will be divisive. The previous entries were all extremely simplistic, in a good way. Serious Sam 4's core movement and combat design is still what you would expect. Large levels, tons of enemies, and weapons and items to pick up. And if you get lost, you can now just follow the objective markers. But now it has headshots, it has a skill tree, it has usable items, and it has primary and secondary objectives. But before all that, let's just take a look at the game's toys of destruction. The knife returns and works much the same as in the classics. Short range, but quick and powerful. The Deagle bootleg is back too, dealing low damage but having infinite ammo and decent accuracy. The shotgun and the double-barreled shotgun both seem to have taken cues from Serious Sam 2. The shotgun has a tighter spread and is noticeably more effective at longer distances than its incarnations in the Encounters and in 3. It also gets an outfire, which launches grenades that explode on impact, making it very versatile. And unlike in 3, it doesn't need to be reloaded. The double-barreled shotgun is faster, and combined with its widespread and damage, it's very useful against clusters of enemies. Later in the game, you get the automatic shotgun, which, as the name implies, can quickly fire in full auto, but also needs to reload every 20 shots. Which is actually a good thing, since it can take advantage of the full speed ahead skill, drastically increasing its firing rate. The assault rifle hasn't changed much from 3. It shoots fast and is accurate when using the iron sights, but now carries 80 rounds per magazine. The minigun returns to the classic firing rate, but holy crap, it also feels different. Shooting this thing into a crowd of weaker enemies and watching them all explode is incredibly satisfying. The rocket launcher fires a bit faster now, but the rockets themselves travel a bit slower. Most importantly, its upgrade lets you prepare up to 5 rockets that target up to 5 enemies, or you can just fire them all against a single target for massive damage. The grenade launcher returns, once again with the launching distance being based on how long you hold the fire button. But it also gets a cluster bomb upgrade, letting you trigger an explosion that splits into 5 smaller grenades. The FRPCL is a completely new toy, which launches a flying chainsaw that digs into enemies until it runs out of fuel, or until the enemy dies and it flies towards another. It's extremely effective against groups of weaker enemies, quickly killing multiple targets with a single chainsaw. There's no separate chainsaw weapon, but its alternate fire functions as one. The laser gun has been rebalanced, dealing more damage with each shot and making high-pitched squeals. It also has the Death Ray as an alternate firing mode, and boy does it live up to its name. It eats ammo like popcorn, but deletes everything in a flash. Big boys all die in seconds, and weaker enemies are instantly evaporated with a light tap of the trigger. The Devastator is back from Serious M3, but with a free scope this time. It fires very powerful projectiles at high speeds with excellent accuracy, working great against more resilient enemies and potentially even killing some with a single headshot. The C4 is back too, but pretty much identical. The sniper rifle no longer has variable zoom and is still inaccurate without the scope, but deals the same damage with or without it, and has a faster firing rate that can be boosted with full speed ahead. Last but not least is the good old cannon, which remains the same as always. Charge up and fire stupidly powerful cannonballs that chip everything in the way. And I'd just like to interject for a moment to mention how much better guns and combat in general feels in 4 compared to the previous games. The sounds, the animations, the gore that explodes into an orgy of particles to make your CPU cry in agony, everything just has more oomph this time around. Serious Sam 4 also introduces gadgets, which can be used to trigger a number of effects. The life recovers 50 health, even going over the regular limit. It's also probably the reason why there are so few health pickups that recover more than 25 health. The heart is basically extra lives. When you get wrecked, the game gives you the option of activating one of these nuggets, letting you respawn. The holo decoy summons a fake Sam that distracts enemies for a while. The psychotropic grenade lets out a gas that causes enemies to fight amongst themselves. The drone flies around shooting enemies until it runs out of battery. The rage serum increases your speed and damage for a short period. The time warp causes enemies to slow down. The black hole sucks up enemies into it and eliminates them. Finally, the mini nuke causes a massive explosion that damages enemies caught in the blast. As far as the gameplay structure goes, it's still pretty much the same, really. The game tells you where to go, but you always had to go somewhere anyway? You can find side missions, which typically involve going somewhere off the main path, but that's kind of like certain secret areas in the previous games. Although a good portion of these award you with non-essential items like gadgets or ammo, a few I'd say are pretty much essential since they award you weapons or weapon upgrades. Throughout the game, you also acquire purple balls with questionable substances that Sammy immediately sniffs, granting him a point of Syrian Artifacts of Might, or Sam for short. You can allocate these points into various skills, such as the aforementioned full speed ahead, which temporarily increases the weapon's firing rate after reloading. Then there's things like reloading while sprinting, or dual wielding weapons, or performing melee executions on stronger enemies. And it is just allocation. You can reclaim and reassign your available points at any time. One new addition is headshots, meaning that you can deal a ton of damage with a single shot if you're accurate enough. This has some nifty implications in weapon balance. Previously, the pistols were usually rendered obsolete once you got your hands on something better, since they couldn't deal enough damage to effectively deal with anything beyond trash mobs. Serious M4's pistol is still not particularly relevant later on, but it can be useful against enemies like the Processed. They move fast and come in large groups, but can be dispatched with a quick headshot, something that the shotgun's slower speed can't keep up with. Headshots also let the Devastator and Sniper Rifle quickly dispatch tougher enemies, but my favorite has to be the wearables, which can now be killed with a single blast from the double-barreled shotgun. Dual wielding also brings up some interesting implications. Dual knives are actually fairly effective and rewards high-risk play, with a single slice now killing queers, as well as vampires, adult spiders, and zealots. The old knife and sledgehammer simply couldn't deal damage fast enough to offset the danger. The final dual wielding skill even lets you mix weapons, allowing you to cover for one weapon's weakness with another. Either way you go, remember that it also works together with full speed ahead, further increasing damage output. Reloading in 3 felt like a completely arbitrary addition, but in 4 it was designed to take advantage of this skill. Just keep in mind that dual wielding locks you out of alternate firing modes. At some point, you will take control of a giant robot armed with chain guns and rockets, as well as a curtain of incendiary grenades and a quick dash. These sections are short, but also sweet. Other vehicles include a harvester that just roadkills enemies, a tractor, and bikes that don't have any weapons but lets you fire your regular ones. One particular skill also lets you ride enemies like if they were a vehicle, which is kinda cool. Another similarity to Serious Sam 2 is the existence of NPC allies, which, I don't know, it feels a bit weird for a series that is kind of like a bullet hell in first person. 2's NPCs were practically useless, but 4's are decently competent, and thankfully you don't have to worry about keeping them alive or anything. Overall, all these factors mean the player is capable of dealing much more damage per second than in previous games. But it seems that enemies can too. Even on normal difficulty, I find myself dropping to low health quite frequently, especially when I screw up and eat a faceful of projectiles from commanders or helicopters, and the reptiloids' balls seem more dangerous than their previous iterations. For my second playthrough, I jumped straight into serious difficulty, which I rarely play because I find it to be several points of hell above normal. But funny enough, I thought the jump in difficulty wasn't very big, and I realized that the gadgets really help a lot. The black hole is basically a win button, and the rage serum makes short work of bosses, especially combined with dual wielding and full speed ahead. But I guess it leads me to having some thoughts about the game's overall balance. As mentioned previously, the shotguns have been buffed, and the lack of ammo for other weapons early on means you'll be relying a lot on them. The single barrel shotgun's grenade launcher is also extremely useful, and not as short on ammo as you might expect, making it an all-around excellent weapon. But as you approach the end, the situation changes thanks to the rocket launcher's new lock-on ability, which easily dispatches major biomechanoids and knooms, as well as the headshots, which means that tougher enemies can be easily dispatched with the Devastator. In a way, it makes big, slow enemies much less dangerous than weaker but agile enemies that come in large groups. Their attacks are still dangerous, but dealing with them is trivial compared to getting rushed by lower tier enemies that seem to be more dangerous than the equivalents in previous games. Even Gnars can be a threat this time around. On the other hand, you can easily argue that this rewards skilled play and proper enemy prioritization, so this could be seen as both a good and a bad thing, I guess. But what I do think is certainly bad is that this indirectly affects the value of melee executions, which are already questionable in their usefulness, because while enemies themselves do stop this time around, projectiles don't seem to be affected. Here's how it works. There are multiple skill levels that let you perform executions on stronger enemies, and one that gives you health back for doing it. But to perform executions on the stronger enemies, you first need to inflict a bunch of damage on them until they enter a faltered state. Except the enemies that you would think would be worth using melee executions on are also easily dispatched by, you know, shooting them until they die. Add the fact that the game is very picky about the positioning required to activate them, and congratulations, 30% of your skill tree is practically worthless. Bonus points for still having that completely pointless knockback melee against beheaded soldiers. A perfect example is the Octanian Commander, which blocks some damage with its shield. To perform an execution, you need to be right in front of their shield, which is instantly disabled for some reason. Don't bother going for the sides or the back, it doesn't work. It also restores a whopping 2 health. Personally, I think the melee executions need a serious rework, both functionally and visually, because they aren't even as satisfying as the ones in Serious Sam 3. I mean, they were basically a suicide button after the first few levels, but pulling a Gnar's eye out was something. I'm not expecting Doom Eternal levels of quality here, but these just leave me thoroughly flaccid. Enemy design is both better and worse. Returning enemies have new tricks, and some of the new ones have slightly more elaborate methods to deal with, like the Zealot being impervious to bullets from the front, the vampires teleporting around, and the Pyromaniac and Calypsy, which... Oh no. The Witch Bride has been reworked from her bollocks in 3, now launching projectiles instead of walking you in the air for a few seconds. Like the vampires, she also leaves a trail indicating her movement, which is a nice touch. Helicopters and canoes are also vulnerable to bullets, just like in Fusion. On the other hand, the sound design seems a bit... off? I don't know if it's just the mixing or something else, but I found the spawn and enemy sounds to be hard to tell apart sometimes. Maybe this sounds like nitpicking, but it's kind of a big deal in a game where spatial awareness is so important. This realization hit me like a truck on the framerate quarry, when I was checking out a door and then suddenly got hit without warning. This turned out to be a horde of zealots, which as it turns out, don't seem to make any noise outside of their attack. Seriously, listen to this. It's not as much of a problem, but the muted color palettes and the new graphical flourishes can make enemies hard to discern sometimes. This was never a problem in the classic encounters and 2, but in 4 it can be hard to tell the different humanoids from one another in some situations. As for the Legion system, well, it's a nothing burger. It exists in the first and the last level, for a total of about 20 minutes. It looks really nice, but it's just smoke and mirrors. It's a soft wall that kills you if you don't do what the game wants you to. Those demo videos on friends? None of that is in the game. I get that having this many enemies all aim at you wouldn't be fair during normal gameplay, but come on, you have giant friggin' robots that slaughter hordes of enemies now. Speaking of friends, there's a ton of space with nothing interesting in it, including some areas that seem like they lead somewhere, but don't. I appreciate how open the levels are, but this is Serious Sam. Realizing that the game didn't have the decency to spawn a few Highlander reptiloids or a single health pill felt incredibly unclimatic. The Breakfast in France level is the primary example, and ironically where a good chunk of the pre-release footage was from. Only a fraction of the entire map actually has anything in it, which I learned after spending 20 minutes circling around back to the other side of the map and then driving the bike into water, which apparently counted as over 1000 falling damage. To be fair, Crow Team has been revamping this level. There's now an Easter egg at the end of the road, and it now spawns enemies when you go out of the intended path. In my Encounters video, I criticized the direction that the series was going, and Serious Sam 4 is both better and not really. On one hand, the secrets are much more amusing than the low-effort bollocks in 3, and you have classic moments where you grab a suspiciously placed item in a corner and then the game spawns a gazillion enemies to punish you. Then there's those silly moments where the game plays with your expectations, like this bit here that spawns more and more +1 health pickups along with an equal number of rocketeers, until it just spawns a giant one that shoots projectiles at scenic speeds. This is the kind of cheeky cuntness that I crave, so kudos to Crow Team for listening. Some environments are also pretty colorful despite the realistic art style. After my first playthrough, I boosted the saturation a bit and was pleasantly surprised by just how vibrant the French countryside looks. Speaking of which, holy crap, some of the vegetation looks insanely high resolution. But I have to say that the realistic style itself is kinda bland, and lacks personality if that makes sense. Like, I can look at the encounters and 2 and clearly know that this is a Serious Sam game, whereas 4 doesn't really stand out in the same way, and a handful of levels also just plain look bad. And I can't shake the feeling that the game is a bit inconsistent in what it's trying to be. France and Italy are generally colorful and full of foliage, but the multiple city levels are all the same boring crap. Another example is the female Gnars having this silly over-the-top running animation, when the rest of the game has a more grounded style. The physics also look strange sometimes, as if the physics engine isn't even working properly, like the minor biomechanoids. Readability also took a hit because of this grounded style, with enemies sometimes blending into the environment. And I don't mean reptiloids behind trees, that's actually clever usage. I mean how the dull and muted palettes of enemies can get lost in dull and muted environments in some parts. Even the music is inconsistent. A few levels have blend tracks that just amount to background noise, some have music that would fit perfectly in too, and some feel like they are all trying to be final level music. It's like one person said, hey, let's go back to the tone of the classics, but with modern technology, and another decided that Serious Sam had to be literally serious, so they put on their big boy AAA blockbuster pants because Crow Team has an actual writer on board now. And then there was one mad lad who remembered Serious Sam 2, but all they learned from it was that the game needs to be funny all the time. As for nitpicks, I guess I can start with Natrixa, which now provides information on characters and data items found throughout the levels. But sadly, it lacks the personal tone it had in the encounters, and not having information about historical landmarks is a missed opportunity. It also has stats for enemies on normal difficulty, instead of, you know, based on your current difficulty? Gadgets are also a bit cumbersome since you have to select the gadget weapon and then cycle through them. It would be better to simply have keys to cycle left or right and the key to instantly use them. I noticed that you don't get all your weapon upgrades if you start from an individual level too, which sucks, especially if you want to replay a particular level. I have a few other minor annoyances, like how Born to Run doesn't work with knives. Though it does say fire, so point taken. As for multiplayer, there is no player versus player action this time around, and the co-op player limit has been lowered to only 4 players. On the bright side, the game is priced at 40 currency points rather than the usual 60, soon to be 70 asking price, and the campaign is fairly long for an FPS. On PC, it's also available completely DRM-free on GOG. Although Steam does have the advantage of Steam Workshop whenever that comes anyway. It's also on Stadia if that's your thing, though from what I've seen it's just as big of a mess there as it is on PC. Regardless, the game is, for the most part, entertaining, and I found myself enjoying it more than I expected when I first started. Yet I'm not sure I can recommend it right now. Long story short, the game launched with a number of technical issues. The most egregious bugs you might have seen on some reviews have been fixed, so no characters clipping into doors or anything. And I think this resulted in a knee-jerk reaction from some people, with detractors parroting that it's the worst thing ever despite never actually playing the game, and the ardent fans thinking it's a gift from God and that those who gave it negative reviews don't know what they're talking about because they never saw those problems, since they were fixed with a day one patch. In reality, the answer is somewhere in between. Let's talk performance. The Legion system actually runs pretty smooth, all things considered. The grassy areas can look great, and the high CPU requirements make sense given how far you can push the rendering distance and particle amounts. Special mention goes to the enemy models, which look insanely good. But some parts range between mediocre and pretty bad, and the less we say about the human characters and their animations, the better. The problem is, performance is also wildly inconsistent, and for my first playthrough I ended up capping the framerate to 60 to minimize the constant stuttering. The good news is that it has been significantly improved with updates, and the Vulkan API is now running much smoother overall. The framerate quarry I mentioned originally caused my RTX 2060 to struggle to hit 30fps at 1080p despite having nothing going on. But it's much better now. Some areas that looked like the lighting was completely broken have also been updated. After finishing it once, I fiddled with the console commands for a bit and got it to run much smoother without much visual downgrade. But it's still wildly inconsistent between areas for no apparent reason. Look, I'm not a game developer, but I think there's still work to be done here. I ended my video on the encounters with a rather pessimistic look, but I want to believe that Crow Team is working their hardest to fix these problems. In just a couple of weeks, it went from the half-broken mess you saw on release day to a janky but perfectly playable experience, and I imagine that the developers spent the last few weeks before release desperately trying to fix the most embarrassing bugs. But I don't think it's a stretch to say that SiriusXM 4 wasn't actually finished yet. Between the sound issues, the areas that seem to be missing proper lighting, the areas that lead nowhere, and of course the region system barely existing, there's a lot that doesn't seem right. Sometime after release, Crow Team's community manager also claimed that there was something cool in the works regarding breakfast in France. You know, like that Easter egg, and the new spawning enemies. Why did it end up like this? Who knows? Maybe it's because human malware happened. Maybe it's because SiriusXM 4 wants to punch above its weight. It wants to present a more elaborate story. It wants to have more involved combat. It wants to have mind-blowing battles with thousands of enemies at once. It wants to be a big boy blockbuster. But Crow Team and Devolver Digital don't have the resources of Electronic Arts or Ubisoft, and the resources they do have were eaten away by things like Crow Team Incubator, which strangely enough hasn't resulted in a retro-styled SiriusXM boomer shooter yet, and believe me, there's a market for that. Maybe someone decided that the game had been delayed enough, and that they had to release it at some point. Maybe the Stadia release had some influence in that due to a financing deal or something. It should also be noted that Alan Radifak, one of the founders and the lead programmer for the Sirius engine, left the team in 2019 to join Google and work on Stadia. Wink wink, nudge nudge. Whatever the reasons, I think they should have just issued a statement about the state the game is in and released it on Early Access for a while. They could get extra funding this way while still receiving direct feedback, and players would understand that the game simply wasn't finished yet. I don't know, but I think a lot of the backlash could have been avoided. But hey, maybe being completely acquired by Devolver will result in Crow Team getting more resources and better support so that they can bring the game up to the standards they envisioned. But for now, maybe wait for Christmas or something, unless you're really interested in the game. I don't want to sound like I'm making excuses for the game's launch, but there's a lot to like about SiriusXM 4. Yeah, it doesn't hold a candle to the classic encounters, but it's a major step forward from 3, and I hope that once this all blows over, the reception will evolve to a more positive one. The ball is in your court, Crow Team.